billions of dollars circulate the wine industry every year. Whenever that much money is involved, people will always be lurking in the shadows trying to cheat the system. Rudy Kurniawan was a wine enthusiast. He was the toast of the town among high-end dealers and collectors. However, he was also a criminal and the mastermind behind the largest underground wine operation in history. But how exactly did he scam wine? How big did his shady system grow? And what was the clue that allowed the FBI to pounce and finally close a case that had gone on for years? Cheers to that. Let's find out. Americans love wine. That's just a fact. The United States is by far the largest consumer of wine in the world, downing 4.3 billion bottles of wine per year. Most of it, however, isn't made in the US, but over in Europe. The three biggest wine producers in the world, Italy, France, and Spain, together account for 51% of world wine production. That's over half of the 270 million hectoliters annually produced. Whatever way you look at it, that's a lot of wine, and it adds up to a lot of money being passed around. Over $61 billion in the USA alone, with bottles raking in as much as 60% profit each. While you can pick up a bottle for a few bucks at the local liquor store, that's just one end of the spectrum. Bottle prices vary radically. Just like art, wine is collectible. We've witnessed bottles of Chateau Margaux 1787, Chateau Lafite 1869, and Cheval Blanc 1947 sell for well over $200,000. However, it's a 73-year-old bottle of French Burgundy that reigns supreme, drawing in a nearly incomprehensible $558,000 at an auction in 2018. The 1945 Romani Conti became the most expensive bottle of wine ever sold. So whether it's a Merlot, Cab, Pinot Noir, Champagne, or even a sweet port, you can clearly see that there is a monumental amount of cash spent by the wine aficionados of this world. Of course, when stacks of money that big are at play, there's always someone ready to bend the rules and exploit the system. This is Maureen Downey. Oh no, she's not the one doing the exploiting, she's the one helping to squash it. She is one of the world's foremost experts on wine fraud, affectionately dubbed the Sherlock Holmes of wines. And according to Maureen, the face value of counterfeit wines in circulation easily exceeds several billion dollars. It's not even solely wines that are ripped off, it's all types of alcohol. Spirits are actually targeted for counterfeiting more frequently than wine. However, there's a noticeable difference in why we see more fake Shiraz than fake ripped off rum. The spirit industry attacks the issues of counterfeiting head-on because they're usually larger firms with extra money in the bank. The wine landscape, on the other hand, is chock-full of small companies and independent, family-run vineyards. Even if they're not small, they're discreet. The French labels, for example, often choose not to press charges when finding fake bottles, preferring to keep their name and reputation squeaky clean. One of the shady characters responsible for this ongoing counterfeiting is a name that sat on the FBI's watch list for a very, very long time. Taking the wine auction industry by storm was none other than this man, Rudy Kurniawan. He had a fondness for wine when he first started rubbing elbows with the high rollers at auctions, but he also had a fondness for breaking the rules. When we consider the damage he did to the industry, if we fast forward to today, the wine markets have never fully recovered. They're still rattled with pricing uncertainty and skepticism because of Rudy's mischievous antics. Don't pop your cork just yet, because we'll get back to Rudy a little later. For now, there's a question we need to answer. How can someone counterfeit wine in the first place? Well, technically, it's not the wine itself that you're ripping off, but the bottle. As a scammer, it doesn't matter what you're putting inside the bottle so long as, on the outside, it looks authentic at the point of sale. Let's take a peek at an example. Say, the Romani Conti DRC from Burgundy in France, a 1996 vintage. By the way, vintage doesn't necessarily mean old or classic like, say, a vintage Mustang. In the world of winemaking, vintage simply refers to the year it was produced. Anyway, a set of 8 of these bottles fetched $224,900 at auction by Sotheby's London in 1996. So we know there's value attached to the brand, the bottle, and the vintage. Now, how would someone like Rudy forge a bottle? There are a number of ways to do it, actually. First off, there's replicating. The counterfeiter can print their own Romane Conti labels and shape their own bottles. Although the more expensive the target wine, the more precision is needed in the knockoff bottle and label. There's also what the wine fraud industry calls unicorns. A perfect example of this would be if we tried to sell you something that we claimed to be a 5-liter bottle of high-class 1945 Chateau Cheval Blanc from Bordeaux. If you did some digging, you'd realize the black and white fact: the 5-liter size was not introduced in Bordeaux until 1978. not. It exists only in the mind of the scammer and the fool who falls for it. The total value of fake wine, according to Maureen Downey, is around $3 billion, and it's estimated that 20% of all bottles are scams. Sometimes they're cheap and easily distinguishable, such as fraudsters changing the label from the Australian Penfolds brand to Penfoids with an I, where the L should be, and hoping buyers won't notice the difference. Other times, like in Rudy's case, the bottles are exact counterfeit copies. Even though winemakers are adding more and more details to their labels to throw off scammers, there's still one glaring problem to counterfeiting prevention. What's the best way to fake an authentic bottle? Avoid it being fake in the first place, by which we mean finding a real legitimate bottle and simply refilling it with dirt cheap wine. As long as you're clever enough to think of all the factors, like the old discolored cork, then it's a huge illegal moneymaker. Often high-end restaurants forget to destroy the bottles, so a clever dumpster diver could relatively easily intercept a potential gem. The invisible ink and micro-writing on the labels used to deter counterfeiters would already be there, since the bottle is authentic. Of all the people scammed by Rudy Kernyawan, there were seven main victims. One of those was William Koch, or Bill for short, a billionaire yachtsman, entrepreneur, and wine investor. 20,000 bottles of fine and rare wine from Bill's personal collection went to auction in 2016. Fetching a staggering $21.9 million. So as you can see, he didn't mess around when it came to buying exclusive, expensive wines. A few years earlier, when Bill realized that some of the bottles in his collection were a ruse, he hired private detectives. That would prove to be one of the first steps in taking down the greatest wine scammers of all time. Yep, that'd be Rudy. Based on the notion that 20% of wines around the world are shady, we can infer that scams cost Bill Koch at least $4.4 million. Now, let's swivel our attention back to Rudy, the cunning wine fraud who set new records in wine deceit and disguise. Although clearly not cunning enough in the end, otherwise he wouldn't have been caught. Hidden away in his California home, Rudy had built a fully equipped counterfeiting workshop that allowed him to execute his simple yet brilliantly effective underground operation. On hand, he had a variety of corking tools, label makers, an array of empty bottles in all shapes and sizes, and extensive tasting notes. The method: place new wines in old bottles, expensive on the outside, trash on the inside, knowing full well that the most expensive wines are so rarely drunk that few can claim to actually know how they're supposed to taste. Okay, so what about distribution? The key to all of Rudy's sales came from his persona. Rudy was able to establish a name for himself in the industry. It was this industry reputation as a rare wine connoisseur and the trust that came with it that helped him to transition to fraudulent sales without so much as a weird look. FBI Special Agent Jim Wine, no relation to the product, said it best. These were not stupid people, they just took it on faith that Rudy was telling the truth. All in all, Rudy's scam empire was valued at around $550 million. Hold on a second, why did the FBI let this drag on so long? According to Maureen Downey, it was because they constantly reached dead ends. Agents would dig until they had all the answers in front of them. However, neither the winemakers nor the victims would be willing to come forward and press charges. They didn't want their reputation damaged as a collector or as a producer. To which the FBI said, well, if you're not persecuting, we're not going to waste our resources. And so wine fraud went on and on and on. As the years passed, authentication experts saw more and more dodgy consignments emerging from these record-breaking auctions. And whose name kept popping up? Rudy's. With the evidence mounting, the FBI needed someone to get behind them. They needed a mindset shift. They needed companies and collectors to want to persecute. Well, that shift was coming. It just needed a spark. Remember the unicorns we mentioned earlier? Selling something that doesn't actually exist? Well, Rudy messed up by making one and getting caught. In 2008, he offloaded a number of Domaine Ponceau Clos St. Denis Grand Cru wines, with vintages ranging from 1945 through 1971. Laurent Ponceau, head of Domaine Ponceau, quickly interfered. He stated that the Clos St. Denis variety had only been released for the first time in 1982, some 37 years later than Rudy was selling. This was one of the key moments that paved the way for other French winemakers to join the hunt, deciding to cooperate with investigators, hoping to stop the fraud. Winemakers had started to become suspicious of all the outlandish claims that Rudy was making. How could he have collected so many rare vintages? Where did he get all the money to create and resell an expensive collection? It just didn't seem right. As soon as the FBI was approved for a search warrant, it was game over. The FBI stormed Rudy's home in Arcadia, California on March 8, 2012, uncovering the lab and finding enough evidence to make an arrest. Amongst the findings were cheap Napa wines with notes indicating that they would be passed off as older vintages of Bordeaux. At court, despite saying he was sorry, the verdict was unanimous. Rudy was found guilty by a jury at trial in December of 2013 and was sentenced to a 10-year prison term for his elaborate counterfeiting scheme. On top of that, they also found him guilty of bank fraud, with more than $7 million in outstanding loans, not to mention that he had no legal immigration status in the country. Rudy was forced to pay more than $28 million in restitution to his victims and forfeit $20 million to the authorities. So what's the most expensive bottle of wine that you've ever bought? Let us know in the comments. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and thank you for checking out The Richest. We'll see you next time.